morning, this is Gordon Stiles, the founder and CEO of Star Rapid. I've been involved in rapid prototyping and new product development for over 35 years, and today I'm going to blow your mind with some serious engineering for serious engineers.
Serious engineering.
Today we're going to talk about the top 5 rapid prototyping methods that we recommend for most applications. But before we begin, let me give a huge shout out to Mr. Nishant Shah and his team at Imaginarium in Mumbai, India. Nish used to work with us at Star Rapid before joining India's largest independent 3D printing service bureau as managing director, and we're still huge friends. Nish kindly provided technical input as well as some of the graphics in today's video. Thanks, mate. Wait until the end of the video to hear me tell a few cool stories from back in the 90s when 3D printing had just got started. Ever since people started making stuff and then tried to make new and improved stuff, there's been a need to make prototypes. They're used for design evaluation, testing, certification, as proof of concept for crowdfunding campaigns, and as bridges to full production. For prototypes, we suggest CNC machining, polyurethane vacuum casting, and 3 plastic 3D printing methods, SLA, FDM, and powder bed fusion. By the way, in this video, when we talk about 3D printing for prototypes, we really mean plastic printing. That's because although metal printing can indeed make prototypes, and very good ones, it's a fundamentally different engineering and design challenge, and it's not especially rapid as a prototyping method. So return your seat backs to the upright position, make sure your tray tables are stowed and locked, buckle your seat belts, and for heaven's sake, turn off that cell phone before takeoff. 1. CNC machining. Many people don't realize that CNC machining is an ideal prototyping method for the right project. It's fast, highly accurate, and very versatile as it works with almost any kind of material, both plastic and metal. There are also no minimum quantities, so one part can be made just as easily as 1,000. You'll want to consider CNC machining if you need strong mechanical parts that are fully functional and have precise tolerances. Basically, full production quality, but in a limited quantity. CNC machining is not ideal for thin-walled plastic boxes, housings, or parts with deep cavities. For these shapes, you might want to consider thermoforming, 3D printing, or vacuum casting instead. 2. Polyurethane vacuum casting, or VC. Vacuum casting, also known as cast urethane in North America, uses a solid master pattern to make a silicone rubber mold. The pattern can be made from any material, but it's often made from a plastic 3D printed part. The master pattern is suspended in an empty casting box. The box is then filled with liquid silicone, and after the silicone is cured, it's cut open and the pattern removed, leaving behind a hollow cavity that can now be filled with a casting resin to make a copy of the original. If the master pattern has a gloss finish or a textured finish, this will be faithfully reproduced on the surface of each casting, so no need for secondary finishing in many cases. You can also have clear parts or just about any color you desire. Vacuum casting is great for making near production quality plastic parts that look and perform just like plastic injection moldings, but without the need to invest in expensive metal tools. Parts can also be overmolded, and resins come in a variety of shore hardnesses, from extremely rigid all the way to rubber-like materials, something that you cannot do with CNC machining, for example. The silicone molds last up to about 20 copies or so, making this a great way to create enclosures and other semi-hollow forms in small quantities. If needs be, you can also paint, sand, and machine them. 3. Stereolithography, or SLA. This was the very first additive manufacturing process, and it's still improving all the time. It was launched commercially in 1987, and I actually bought my first SLA 3D printer, an SLA 250, way back in 1993. Ooh, 1993. Someone give that poor boy a meal. Now that's a 32-inch waist right there. Stud. I was young, I needed the money. To use an SLA, you first take your 3D CAD model and add supports to it. You then slice that data into thousands of very thin layers. Using a UV scanning laser, you then draw out each layer, one on top of another, curing the resin into a solid plastic 3D prototype. SLA is fast and versatile, and there are many resins to choose from that offer different cosmetic and mechanical properties. These are usually divided into different grades, such as prototyping resins, engineering resins, and medical and dental resins. You can even add glass fibers or aluminium powder to get greater strength. The surface finish is excellent, but remember that after printing, parts still need to be washed and then post-cured to achieve maximum strength and stability. SLA parts are also hygroscopic, which means that they absorb humidity over time. That's why we store our SLA parts in sealed bags with desiccant or in dehumidification cabinets to keep them dry and flat. 4. Fused Deposition Modelling, or FDM. This is the 3D printing system most people are familiar with nowadays. It uses filaments of common plastics like PLA or ABS, or engineering resins like PEEK and ULTEM. If you're interested, you can learn more about those by checking out the helpful link over here. There, maybe. I'll put it there this time. The filament is extruded through a heated nozzle where it's melted, and this melt is then deposited layer upon layer to form the part. Kind of like silly string. FDM is one of the least expensive additive manufacturing methods, and it's very popular with home enthusiasts and small 3D printing bureaus. For someone needing a prototype, it's usually quite easy to find a local makerspace or digital printing bureau that can help you print out your designs quickly and cheaply. But be aware that the resolution is not particularly good, so your parts will likely need some post-build sizing or finishing work. 5. Powder bed fusion. There are two main types of powder bed fusion: selective laser sintering, SLS, and multi-jet fusion, MJF. They both use a sealed chamber filled with a powdered substrate where a roller is used to lay down material and smooth and compress the top surface. Both systems mostly use nylon. SLS fuses the nylon with a laser, whereas MJF fuses the nylon with a somewhat complex system of chemical agents and infrared energy. At the end of the day, both systems will give you a robust and moderately accurate prototype for functional testing. MJF tends to be lower cost as the quantity goes up, and is therefore somewhat better suited than SLS as a low volume production process. There are several advantages to powder bed fusion. First, parts are self-supporting, so additional structures are not needed. Second, the entire build volume of the chamber can be used for maximum efficiency. So that's all the time we have for today, and hope to see you next time. Don't forget to ring the bell, print, like, and subscribe. We hope you learned some helpful information that you can use in your next rapid prototyping project. And of course, we're standing by to offer our professional assistance when you contact us at the link below. And don't forget, we're the people that do serious engineering for serious engineers.
Serious engineering.
Okay, I've got a couple of little interesting stories for you. I first saw stereolithography 3D printing back in, I think it was 1991, on a technology program in the UK called Tomorrow's World. British Aerospace had brought a machine in. 1993, my little engineering business wasn't going so good, so I decided I need a big change. You know, I need a step up somehow in my business. And I decided, okay, that's it. I'm sick of all this little engineering. I'm going to do 3D printing. It looks super sexy. It looks like something new and innovative, out there, high growth, whatever. I was just so excited by the technology. So I got in touch with 3D Systems, and these guys sent me a video of the SLA250 in action. This is the small one. And I got this video, it was a VHS, you put it in the machine, you switch it on, and this thing started up. And right at the beginning, it was the way the guy introduced the name of the technology. I was literally sold as soon as I heard the name. I'll do it like this, and it went something like this. Stereolithography, the technology of the future. Something like that, anyway. And I was just like, I just love the way the guy even says that word. I mean, who can't sell stereolithography? Even though we change it to SLA, and just about nobody even knows the name of stereolithography now, but damn, I was sold on it. Anyway, I went down to London, looked at a machine, it was £168,000, and I said to the guy, I want it. He said, do you have any money? And I said, no, I don't. He said, well, how are you gonna pay for it? I said, I don't know. But anyway, 6 months later, I'd raised about £500,000, bought my first SLA, had it installed in my little factory up in northeast of the UK, and I got on with it. And we ended up being the largest 3D printing bureau in the UK by the year 2000 when I sold that business. That business was called Styles RPD. Now, one other little story I want to tell you is about FDM. So I got my video about stereolithography on a VHS cassette, and I decided I wanted my SLA machine, and I was almost at the point of ordering it when some guy got in touch with me from a company called Stratasys, and he said, oh, we've got this technology. I think you might like it. It's lower cost than stereolithography. And I said, well, okay, send it over. I watched the video and I watched this thing building apart. And whereas an SLA is kind of like this and it does its little thing like that, the FDM was like this. It's going around so fast, and you see this part getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger so quickly. And I'm like, oh my God, this thing's like 10 times faster than an SLA machine. Why would I buy an SLA machine if an FDM is so quick? So I rang the guy up and I said, Jesus, your machine is so quick, man. I've never seen anything so quick. He said, well, it's not that quick. Well, what are you talking about? I said, well, I watched your video and it's quick. And he said, yeah, we speeded up the video like 10 times because obviously it's a bit boring to watch at normal speed. Anyway, I bought an SLA machine in the end. I didn't buy an FDM, never did. To be honest, I'm not a great fan of FDM, but I am a huge fan of SLA. I love it. Anyway, there's my little story.